Well, good morning, everybody. It's 9 o'clock, time to start. We have again a busy day today, same as yesterday. We have 8 hours of lectures. Today, everything about self-healing. So, 2 talks in the morning about self-healing mechanisms and self-healing using bacteria in concrete. And in the afternoon, we have 4 hours about modeling techniques and how you can apply them for self-healing, to study self-healing mechanisms. So the first presenter of today is my colleague Henk Jonkers. He will discuss with you different techniques for self-healing in concrete and maybe also other materials. And well, he will present different cases and also try to discuss with him how you can use these techniques in your projects. So Henk, I give you the floor.
Okay, thank you, Erik, for introducing me. I hope everything will be clear. Erik, I just cannot now see the chat anymore. So I can only see the full screen from my own presentation.
Yeah, but then you can do the chat in the break. You can look at the questions, or afterwards you can answer them.
Okay, we will do that.
Yeah.
Okay. So welcome, everybody. Nice that we can have our event online today. So I will give a presentation on self-healing concrete, and I would like to go into, in the first part, mostly into mechanisms of self-healing and also methods, how to assess self-healing. I would like to have an open discussion. So for the PhDs who are following my presentation online, do unmute yourself if you have a question, because maybe I go too fast on some parts. And otherwise, if you have questions, put them on the chat. But then during the break, I will have a look at the chat and see what questions there are, so I can then start to answer the questions in the second part of the presentation. So I hope you see my first slide. And here it shows several images. You see Erik and myself in the lab working on self-healing, sample of self-healing concrete. And on the left-hand side, we see an image of a tree. So this is why this tree and why this building. You see something peculiar here on this tree, because it is responsive to changes in its environment. And so we see this big bend in this tree. So the tree was growing, and then it suddenly was confronted with a part of a roof. That was not nice, because the tree wants to grow up, to go towards the sun. So then it decided to take a detour. Now, this is something that we would also like to implement in our materials. Can we make them responsive? So in such a way that if conditions in the environment change, that they are able to respond to that. So what are the topics of today? First, I would like to give a short introduction about the topic of self-healing concrete. So why do we need self-healing concrete? And then I would like to go into the codes, design codes. So why do we need self-healing again? If we have very clear codes on how to build and how to design concrete. So if the codes are perfect, then there should also be no need for self-healing. Now, of course, there is a need, and this is what I would like to discuss and show to you. Then we have a discussion. I will show you an overview of different self-healing concepts, different mechanisms, and then also on assessment methods. So how can you really quantify self-healing? Then we will have a short break, coffee. I probably need coffee around that time, so that will roughly be in an hour, I hope. And then I will go to the second part of the presentation. This is an overview, short overview of the self-healing research that we do in Delft. It is also concerns bacteria in the concrete, but I just want to show you what we have done over the last years. And I know that Willy Verstraeten will follow up. So after 11 o'clock, Willy Verstraeten will give a presentation, and he will go more in depth about self-healing concrete in which we use bacteria as a self-healing mechanism. Now, first some facts, concrete facts. Maybe you have seen this before, but worldwide we see that concrete is the most used building material. So in comparison to, for example, timber or steel, we use much more concrete. So roughly on average, we can say that we cast 1 cubic meter of concrete per person per year. So this amounts to roughly 7.4 billion cubic meters of concrete that is produced each year. Well, this is a lot. Also in terms of money, if we see how much money is spent on constructions and also maintenance worldwide, this is a staggering number. And so I put 2.3 trillion, so this means 10 to the 12th of euro is spent each year on construction. This is a lot. And about roughly half of that is for new constructions, so to build new, and almost the other half is for maintenance and repair. Now, if you make a very simple calculation and you say, what will it save us if we can reduce the need for maintenance by 20%, then you see that we already can save an amount of more than 200 billion euros per year. Now, the same is for a longer surface life. So if you can extend the lifetime of a structure by also only 20%, that would already also save more than 250 billion euro each year. And so there's a lot to gain in reducing maintenance and also extending the surface life of concrete. So this is already an argument why we should make self-healing concrete. Now, this is an image I found on internet. This is a bridge that collapsed, and this was due to corrosion of the embedded reinforcement steel. Now, there was a report from the United States, which made also calculations, and they said that there is indeed also a very big amount of money only in the United States is spent each year on maintenance and repair actions for only highway infrastructure. So that amounts to roughly $4 billion per year. So only for highway bridges. So one specific application, but it also shows that we can really earn and save a lot of money if we can reduce all these maintenance and repair activities and make sure that our structures will last very long. Now, why self-healing again? Now, this is a photograph I made 2 years ago on the beach in Scheveningen, which is very close to Delft. And this is a jetty that goes over land, but partly also over the sea. And on this jetty, there are a lot of shops and promenades, so you can walk there. But if you look at the underside, you see something very disturbing. So what you can see here is spalling of the concrete cover. So parts of the concrete cover are completely gone. And this is because we see that we have corrosion, ongoing corrosion of the embedded reinforcement bars. And so if the bars start to corrode, oxidation products are being formed, which takes more volume. So you will get expansion of the steel, which results in internal stress to concrete. And then when this stress is more than the tensile strength of the concrete, then you get this spalling events. So this is what we can say is the onstart of the end of the construction. So you really need to make some repairs here. Otherwise, you will have the same happening as in the previous picture, that we will have collapse of this structure. Now, if we now make a comparison between different strategies, so what is strategies that mankind does if they make materials, and how is that in nature? So we make comparison between man-made and natural materials. Now, typically what we see here is the aula of the Delft University of Technology, and you see a very robust construction. Now, it looks very sturdy, very durable. So this is typically a strategy that we as humans use. We make things durable, hoping that we will not get any damage during its service life, its intended service lifetime. So this aula was built to last for at least 100 years. And if you indeed do it robust enough, then you hope that the degradation mechanisms will be very slow on this acting on this material, so that you hardly need to do any repairs. So this is the concept, the strategy, what we call of damage prevention. So you prevent damage from occurring by making your structures extremely robust. Now, this is sometimes problematic because that's what we can see here. There is a house that was built, but there was a sudden event that was not considered before. So you see this big boulder, this big rock that came rolling down from a hill which is nearby, and it crashed into this structure. So now a lot of damage is done. So although the design was in line with the damage prevention concept, there was still a lot of damage done because conditions were different than was expected before. Now, so this, we can say this material is now not responsive. So it cannot adapt to changing conditions in the environment. Now, how is this with natural materials? Now, like the tree in the first image that I showed, you see a similar situation here. Also, a big rock came rolling down the hill and it crashed into this tree. Now what you see, the tree can adapt. It can respond and it will start growing. It will actually fortify the part where the damage was done, and it can still keep on growing and doing its thing. So nature has adopted a completely different strategy of what we as humans do. So nature uses the concept of damage management. So it says we can allow a certain level of damage because we have a mechanism, an inbuilt mechanism that can be adaptive and can be activated at the moment that it is needed. So when certain damage is done. Now this is a bone. This is an X-ray picture of a human bone, and there's something interesting what you can see here. So this is also the strategy that nature uses in making building materials. You see that the most part of this bone is actually hollow or very porous. So it is these hollow parts are not very strong. But you also see on the borders that there is a lot of dense material being formed. Now, these are the parts where actually strength is required, because this is specifically the parts in the structure where forces play. It can be tensile forces, can be compressive forces. So this is where the bone needs to be strong. So why would you spend a lot of energy and a lot of material in parts of your structure where it is not needed? So this is a lesson we can learn from nature. If we follow nature, how nature builds and design, we can maybe also benefit from that. So lightweight porous materials, you apply that where it is allowed, and you just apply most of the material and strengths where it is actually required. So this will save a lot of energy and also will save a lot of resources. Now, to continue the story with this bone, we can actually see that also in nature, sometimes an overloading event happens, like you can see in this X-ray image, series of X-ray images. On the left image, you can see that this bone is broken. So maybe this person went skiing and he fell down and the bone was overloaded and was broken. Now, he went to the hospital and the doctor put it straight. So you can see that in the middle picture. And then after time, you can see this self-healing repair mechanism starting to work. So this now results in actually repair, and it results in a material that is in this part actually stronger than in other parts of the bone. So nature has learned that this overloading resulted in damage. Now, in order to prevent this in the next time, nature took care and made this part actually stronger as it was before. So this again is a nice case of damage management. Now, if we now go to our construction materials and we typically focus on concrete, then we can also think of different properties. Now, PSDs, I would like you to think for a minute. So what are now very important properties that our concrete should have, so how should it perform, in which different ways, so what could be possible damage mechanisms that result in loss of functional performance of specific properties. So in other words, what would be typical type of lost properties that we would like to regain with cell healing? Now I have put some images here. So look at those images and think what you see and how you can link this to a certain property of concrete. So I give you 1 minute. Please unmute yourself if you PhDs have an idea. So what are typical properties that concrete should have, and which properties might be affected by a certain degradation or damage mechanism, and that we need to target with self-healing? Who has an idea here? Who can I give the word? Please unmute yourself.
Maybe I can try to answer maybe the property that can be recovered, for example, the strength regain and also the water permeability.
Yes, very good, Harry. So you said strength and water permeability.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what type of strength? What do you think? Are there different types of strength that are important?
It's the regain of the compressive strength.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, that's very good. Water tightness, that's also an important aspect. Something else?
Also, the young modulus of the concrete is affected when it has some crack. I mean, so it loses its stiffness. And also when self-healing appears, self-healing is completed, so it could recover its stiffness in elements.
Yeah. Very good, very good. It's also an interesting property. Maybe a last one. So this is typically showing, I think, in the picture that you see on the bottom right part. Well, let me give some clues. So what I thought of myself, indeed, strength loss can be compressive strength. But I think more importantly would be tensile strength or flexural strength. Indeed, water tightness is an important property. Those are properties which are related to durability, and so to the lifetime of concrete. So that could be corrosion of the embedded reinforcement, what we should like to delay this process. Maybe resistance against other degradation mechanisms like freeze and thaw damage, but maybe also aesthetics. That is also a property of concrete. And like you see in the picture that I showed on the bottom part on the right, you see a very nasty crack in your plaster. And this is of course not very beautiful if it is in your house indoors, if you have a nice plastered wall in your sitting room and suddenly you get a big crack, then it doesn't look very nice. So also aesthetics could theoretically be something that is interesting to try to heal. So we see that we have a whole list of different properties which can be lost and which we would like to regain by a specific self-healing mechanism. Now you can think of different mechanisms, but again, you always have to link it to this specific property that you would like to regain. Sometimes it will be very difficult to come up with a one self-healing mechanism that can actually target all these different properties. So you have to think first, so what is my construction? What are the different performance requirements? What could be possibly a degradation mechanism or a damaging mechanism that plays on my construction? So what type of problems will I expect to occur? And then you should focus on that specific problem and then think of a certain self-healing mechanism that can actually regain that specific lost property. So what we have, what have we now learned from nature? As how should we now in the future make our man-made materials? Well, we should, that the idea is to combine the both concepts. So we should make materials which are very durable, so very long lasting. But at the same time, we should learn from nature that you should also not overdo, so that you, when you incorporate a self-healing mechanism, that you can probably save a lot of energy and a lot of materials by not over-designing your construction. So then we would have a self-healing material that is able to do damage management. And so it can be a responsive material that can then actually react to changing environmental conditions. Now, these are for few images what you can see from practice. Nowadays constructions, if you walk around, you see concrete constructions which are affected by some degradation phenomena which are visible on the surface. So you may have some wear resulting in porosity, and porosity means that you have absorption of water, maybe retainment of water, that makes your concrete very susceptible to growth of biology. So then you might get some mosses growing on your concrete, but you might also have some cracks through which all kind of aggressive agents ingress in your concrete, starting to degrade your reinforcements. So that's what you see on the image on the bottom right side. But also cracks may result in leakage issues. So like this in this basement on the top picture, you see a lot of water that is actually ingressing through the permeable wall, resulting in all kind of leakage issues. So cracking can result in leakage and reinforcement corrosion, but also porosity, so wear of your construction, can also result in frost damage and can also be a damaging mechanism that limits the durability, so the service lifetime of your concrete. Now here's an overview. This is a nice drawing which came from an article that was published almost 30 years ago in 1990, but it shows very nicely what type of mechanisms can play on your concrete construction that would result potentially in formation of cracks. So you see it here indicated by ABC. So this is an example of plastic settlements where you can have bleeding in your concrete mix, resulting or maybe in rapid early drying. That can be a reason for crack formation. You can have plastic shrinkage, but you can also have some reinforcement that is too close to the surface, what also might result in cracking formation. Thermal actions, so if your concrete hardens, it produces heat. So, and by heat, it means that your concrete wants to swell, so it will expand, and vice versa. When it then sets and is cooling down again, then you will have shrinkage of the material, but might also result in formation of different cracks. Also, poor curing might result in too much evaporation of the water, the concrete water from the surface, also resulting in crack formation. So there are a lot of different mechanisms that can actually result in cracking, which is not good, because this would result in this typically leakage issues or maybe durability related issues like frost damage or maybe corrosion of the embedded reinforcements. Now, why are these cracks problematic? I already mentioned it, but we see here also in a drawing, you see that we need a concrete rebar. So that concrete rebar is there because it must provide strength, tensile strength to the concrete, but it must also perform for a very long time. Now, and therefore we need an effective cover depth, an effective cover, a layer of concrete on top of the reinforcement. Now, this concrete, we all know, is slightly porous. So there is a pore system in the concrete that makes material slightly permeable. So you will have over time diffusion of aggressive substances through your concrete cover. So this can be CO2, process of carbonation, but it can also be salts like chlorides. And when those chlorides reach the reinforcement, they start to initiate and speed up the corrosion process. Now, if we have a crack being formed in your surface cover, then we will see a decrease of the active cover zone that we have on the reinforcement. And so effectively, your cover zone will be lowered. So that means that you will have a reduced service lifetime of your concrete. And when the crack is completely going through, so when it goes from the surface to the reinforcement bar, then we have virtually a very open pathway for these aggressive substances, and they can reach immediately the steel reinforcement, and then already you will have corrosion process, what will be again the start of the end of the lifetime of your construction. So this is what we like to prevent, and therefore we have codes, building codes, which are saying in what type of environment is our concrete structure placed. So is it in a mild environment or is it in a very aggressive environment? And in relation to that, you are allowed to have a certain crack width. Now, typically indoors, which is a very mild environment, you are allowed to have cracks of 0.4 millimeter wide, because this would not result in durability issues. However, if you are in a more aggressive environment, so like when you have rainwater, your construction is exposed to rainwater, or maybe salts, de-icing salts, or marine water, more aggressive, then cracks should be limited to only 0.2 millimeter wide. But when you have a water retaining construction, then even these 0.2 millimeter wide cracks would be too much, because it would result in a lot of leakage. So then you should take measures and try to avoid these cracks of 0.2. For example, you can then apply more reinforcement that makes sure that controls the formation of your crack width. So the more reinforcement you put, the smaller the crack width that will occur. You can also take other measures. For example, you can put a plastic membrane in your concrete. But another option would be to make your concrete self-healing, so that also self-healing would result in limiting this crack width. Now, other codes, they also then prescribe. So looking at the different environments your structure is positioned in, what the types of and also maybe in relation to the type of cement that you use, but you should have at least a specific minimum water to cement ratio, because the fewer cement and the more water you have, the more porous your concrete will become. So if you're in a more aggressive environment, your water to cement ratio should be relatively low. Yeah, so that also has a relation to the strength class of your concrete. So in this table, we can see a relationship between the environmental condition. So going from very mild to very severe, you will see that you need a smaller water to cement ratio, and also that you need, in generally speaking, you need a higher strength class of your concrete. But predominantly what we see is that you need a higher cover depth, so the layer of concrete on top of your reinforcement. Now, having said that, then we can say, okay, if we know these norms and if we know how to build and we take care of everything, do we still then need self-healing? Why should we then need self-healing? Now, I have here a very short movie which shows how things are working in practice. So what we see here is a casing where we see some reinforcement bars put in. And now if you look very carefully, you can see in this arrow that there is a spacer being positioned. So the spacer must make sure that you have sufficient cover depth on top of your reinforcement going to the surface. So for example, this should be a distance of at least 4 centimeters in cases of a very aggressive environment where you need at least 4 centimeter cover depths. Now let's see. Move once away. Close up. Space here. Don't start flowing. Space. Boost. First over. Space. Space over. Up. Be gone in this example. Now, what do you think what will happen on the construction site? Will there somebody shout, stop the pumping because we have to reposition the spacers? Otherwise, we run the risk that the reinforcement will start to flex more towards the casing wall, resulting in a lower cover depth. Well, usually this is not the case, I can tell you, because the workers, they only work for a several number of hours per day. They want to go home and they want to eat, have dinner. Maybe they have another job in the evening, so they want to work fast. So they just continue working, because in the end, if they remove the formwork, the casing, who can tell what the actual cover depths will be? So in practice, a lot of errors, mistakes are being made. Maybe knowingly, maybe not knowingly, but codes are not a guarantee for a very sound concrete construction. So this is also one reason why we should actually implement self-healing. So here's a list of reasons. Why is self-healing so important? Well, we can say it can help to save on resources. If we follow this natural concept of damage management, then we don't need to over design, so we don't need to make extremely robust constructions. So that will also be good for the environment. It will lower the environmental footprint of our constructions, so we save resources, we save energy during the construction process, so that will also result in lower harmful emissions to the environment. We also need less repair actions, because we have now an embedded self-healing mechanism. We will have less out of order occurrences, so less repair needs to be done, so the construction can be accessible, so no other costs need to be made there. So this all results in saving a lot of money. And also, also very important, it will also result in a reduced risk of failure. Think of these examples that I showed of these viaducts which collapsed. If you have a self-healing mechanism, then the risk of such a collapse is smaller. And so this is all very positive. So now, next question will be, what are now possible self-healing mechanisms that we can think of? Now, we as scientists, we started to think about self-healing around the year 2000-2005. But before, Hollywood was first, so science fiction, they came up also with ideas of self-healing. How could you make something self-healing? Now there's a nice movie, and in this movie you see that there are two bionic people, so they are half man, half human, half machines. They fight against each other. So one is the T-800, an older model, which is impersoned by Arnold Schwarzenegger, and another one, a robot, is the T-1000, and this robot actually features a very specific material. It's called a nanomorph mimetic polyalloy. Now let's have a look at this picture. It's a very small part of the movie. But what did Hollywood came up with ideas of self-healing? Now you see this small young guy, he is being chased by this, let's call it the Terminator, the T-1000 model. Now, this is Arnold Schwarzenegger. This is the older version of the Terminator. Arnold Schwarzenegger actually wants to protect this young guy, but the young person, the boy, doesn't know. So he is very scared. And now we see that Arnold Schwarzenegger is drawing a very, very big gun. So he wants to hide himself. But Arnold Schwarzenegger is not aiming for the boy. He is expecting the other Terminator to show up. This is the T-1000 model. Now in between, you see this human person. This is the Terminator being hit. So this is a human. he is hit several times. The human is inactivated. Arnold Schwarzenegger, the 800 model, he can cope some damage. So now we start to attack the new Terminator. You see that really a lot of damage now inflicted on this 3000 model. Now it seems at this moment to be completely out of action, out of order. Now we see a marvelous self-healing process happening, reactivating his Terminator, and he is back in action again. So this is so this movie goes on for more than 2 hours, and most of it is fighting, but you will see a lot of self-healing activities happening in this movie, and this is something that will inspire us scientists. So what can we now possibly do in concrete? So I'll stop the movie here. So this is an example of self-healing, but how did it work? Well, in this case in Hollywood, they invented this polymimetic morphic metal that could kind of flow towards a region where damage was done, resulting in healing, not only in healing the wound, but also in full recovery of performance, because you could see that this Terminator was standing up and it could really start to be active again as it was supposed to be. Now, question is, can we do the same in concrete? So concrete is a very nice building material, but one of the problems that we have as scientists is that it is also very cheap. So you see here a value of roughly 80 euro per cubic meter. And this is spent on sand, and gravel, and cement and water. If you mix the water and cement, you get paste, which acts as a glue to glue the sand and gravel together. Sometimes there are other chemicals added, performance enhancers are added to make, for example, the concrete to flow very nicely. And with that, you can make very nice constructions. Now, one issue is the very low cost. So how much can we spend on a self-healing mechanism that will still be feasible in practice? Are people willing to pay that? So now I would like to show you an overview of different self-healing concepts, different self-healing mechanisms. So now I took this image, this cartoon from a Dutch magazine. It says self-healing concrete does not only have advantages. So it shows here a guy who needs to demolish a structure. So he does that, but immediately the structure is back again in full action. Now this is of course wishful thinking. Can we already make concrete like that? No, that will be the future. So what are the different mechanisms that we can think of to make concrete self-healing? Now, we see if we look at the literature, and we made a very nice review article on this. So I put it down here, a review of self-healing concrete for damage management of structures. This was done in the framework of the ZARCOS self-healing concrete program. It was published 2 years ago, 2018, and it gives a very nice overview of self-healing mechanisms. Now here we can distinguish autogenous self-healing. So this is something that the material has already in itself as a mechanism for self-healing. But we can also have autonomous self-healing. So that means that you have on purpose implemented something in your concrete, maybe added to the concrete mix, to strengthen the self-healing performance. So we have autogenous from itself, and autonomous is this, let's say, added, enhanced self-healing. Now we can also have different types of additives. It can be non-encapsulated, but it can also be in form of capsules that we added to the, how we added to the concrete mix. And lastly, we can also have, instead of capsules, we can have vascular networks. And so this mimics the human body. We have blood veins, for example. So and through our veins, blood is transported. This carries all kind of healthy stuff that is required in our body. And we can do the same in self-healing concrete by also trying to make veins in concrete that can actually transport, self-healing, self-healing agents, self-healing chemicals towards the spot where the self-healing is required. So let's first have a look at self-healing mechanisms. Now, this is coming from a paper that also Erik Slangen contributed to. This was published in 2013, but also before, this was actually already shown, these different concepts. Here we see a crack in concrete, a through-going crack, and we see different mechanisms of self-healing. So the first one is swelling. If the concrete takes up water, it may expand and swell. So this may already result in closure of this crack. But we can also have continued hydration of cement particles. We can have the deposition of calcium carbonate minerals in on the crack surface, also resulting in closure of the crack. But we can also have aggregation of all kinds of particles, debris, which are coming with the water that flows through the concrete that may result in blocking of the concrete. So now these two middle mechanisms are the most important ones. And the first one, continued hydration, depends very much on the amount of cement that was present in the initial concrete mix. So the more cement, the higher the chance is that when you have a crack, that there will still be non-hydrated cement particles being present on the surface of the crack that can then undergo secondary hydration and form a concrete material. So again, this very much depends on the type, but particularly on the amount of cement particles that are still present in your concrete matrix at the moment that concrete cracks. Now this second mechanism of limestone formation is very much depending on the amount of calcium hydroxide that is present in your concrete. Now, calcium hydroxide is a mineral also called portlandite, which is being formed after the process of cement hydration. When a cement particle reacts with water, it produces two main products. One is the stone-like, the rock-like material, calcium silicate hydrate, and the other byproduct is calcium hydroxide. Now, calcium hydroxide is a mineral that is relatively soluble in water. So what will happen? It will fall apart in calcium and hydroxide ions. And have, once dissolved in the water, it will also disappear from your crack when you have a certain flow of water. However, if you have formation of CO2, carbon dioxide, when carbon dioxide is present or it is being formed in your concrete, we will see a reaction of CO2 with the calcium hydroxide, and we see the formation of calcium carbonate minerals, so calcium carbonate limestone, and this is not water soluble. So in this instance, in this case, it will start to accumulate on the crack surface. So this will now also result in sealing and closure of this crack. So important take-home message for these two mechanisms. For the first one, you need high amounts of cement. And for the second one, you need high amounts of calcium hydroxide being formed. Now, this is typically formed due to the reaction of water with clinker. So the higher the clinker content in your binder system, the more calcium hydroxide you will have, and potentially this will also give you a very high crack healing potential. Now we have autogenous healing of concrete. So these are these mechanisms like secondary hydration of cement particles, but also, let's say, natural carbonation, so the reaction of CO2 with calcium hydroxide particles that are still being present. But we can also help this process a little bit, this autogenous healing, by making sure that there will be enough moisture in the crack, because moisture is required for the reaction of the cement and the calcium hydroxide particles. And this can, for example, be done by mixing in some fibers which absorb and retain a lot of water. So this can be natural fibers, like for example sea salt fibers. So this we would then call aided autogenous self-healing. So the sea salt fiber itself is not so much helping the self-healing process, but it's actually the water that it retains that does help the self-healing process. So this is aided autogenous self-healing, because autogenous, it still depends on the original type of cement that was in the mix and also the amount of calcium hydroxide that was being formed. Then we can have another form, what we call stimulated autogenous healing. So this is, for example, through the use of specific minerals that you can add to your concrete mix. Now in the Netherlands, we do that already for 30 years. We apply a lot of blast furnace slag in our binder system. So we replace sometimes up to 70% of the clinker, of the Portland cement for blast furnace slag. But you can also use other minerals for that, like fly ash, silica fume, or maybe calcinated clays. So these are typically what we call putzolanic materials. So they are reactive once there is still enough alkalinity in your concrete. So for example, this calcium hydroxide, which is a byproduct from a cement hydration, can also result in the activation of these minerals. And when it is activated, they also start to behave like cement particles. So they will also hydrate and also result in the formation of hydration products. So this is some results that you can also find in this article, which I referenced to here by Kim van Tietelboom, our colleagues from Ghent University. And they show that you do healing underwater. It's very important that you need to expose your specimen all the time to moisture, because it is usually a relatively slow reaction of these secondary cementitious materials. And therefore, it is very important that your concrete doesn't dry out in the meantime, otherwise this reaction will stop. But then you will see that you have actually very effective, well, not so much healing, but densification of your concrete matrix. So the microstructure becomes really, really very dense, thanks to this delayed hydration of these additional minerals which were added to the concrete mix design. Now, very similar to sea salt fibers, we can also add certain synthetic polymers, like super absorbing polymers. Now, this is also then called like stimulated autogenous self-healing, because it acts in the same way as the sea salt fibers. It provides additional water at the moment that self-healing is required. So the actual self-healing is still coming from the concrete mix, so therefore it's still called autogenous, but stimulated because the polymers help to provide the water that is required for the chemical process of self-healing. So now we switch to autonomous healing, and this is that we on purpose add something to the mix design specifically to enhance the self-healing process. Now, this is one possibility, is to use what's called certain crystalline admixtures. So these are chemicals, can be minerals or other chemicals that help the sealing of cracks. Now, these are commercial products, and most of these commercial products don't want to tell what is exactly in the mix, so it is not disclosed. But generally speaking, most of these crystalline admixtures contain these specific mineral oxides, like magnesium oxides, calcium oxides, sulfur oxides or sodium oxides, or maybe other alkaline oxides. And the way they work is that they also react with water, but also with other chemicals like carbon dioxide. So here you see an equation which shows that if you have a mineral oxide in the presence of water and in the presence of CO2, you will see a new mineral being formed, which was much larger than the original mineral. So therefore, these are sometimes also called expansive minerals. So they expand. And by doing this expansion, they have the capacity to seal cracks, so they can make the crack walls grow towards each other, resulting in sometimes complete sealing of cracks. Now we have colleagues from Italy. Our colleague Professor Ferrara has done a lot of work on this, and so there are also a reference here for this specific type of self-healing mechanism. Now the previous one was not encapsulated, but we also can add self-healing agents in forms of capsules to the concrete mix design. Now, capsules can be made in a lot of different forms, a lot of different types. Now here I just listed, I made an overview of what are the different shell wall materials of these capsules that are being used, are being studied at the moment in science. Well, we see a lot of different chemicals that can be used for that. But then we also have a lot of different contents of these capsules. So we call that the cargo. So this is the actual functional healing agent that need to be liberated at the moment that self-healing is required. Now also these cargos can be of very different origin. It can be epoxies. It can be silica, sodium silicate, but it can, for example, also be bacterial spores. Now, then we have also the possibility of macro encapsulation. So it is more or less the same as the previous, but the previous one was micro encapsulation. So very small capsules, smaller than 1 millimeter. And when we want to have more self-healing capacity, then we need to make bigger capsules. So we call that macro capsules, and roughly the definition is that the diameter of those is larger than 1 millimeter. So then every capsule is able to store larger amounts of repair agents. So with that, when that one is delivered, it has the capacity to also heal larger cracks. Now also in literature, we see that there is a lot of different types of materials that are used for the capsule walls. So it can be plastics, can be glass, fibers, even tubes. It can be cementitious materials, expanded clays, for example. It can also be polymers, like what we use in Delft, is polylactic acid type of matrix for the capsules. And then we also see in literature that, again, there are a lot of different cargos, healing agents that can be used as material that needs to be delivered to aid the process of self-healing. There can be certain types of glues, adhesives, so methyl methacrylates, now other types of epoxy resins and so on. But again, you can also do expansive minerals, you can encapsulate them. Sodium silica, or maybe also bacterial spores and nutrients. So there's really a lot to find in literature. Now, another option is not to use capsules, but use vascular systems. Now, vascular systems, I mentioned that mimics our cardiovascular system, so our blood veins. So this would potentially allow you to transport larger amounts of healing agents to a damaged site. Now, also here we see a variety of possibilities if you look into the literature. We see, for example, glass tubes that can be used, but also polymers that can be used as for the tubes. But also we see that cargos can be different, so that you can supply different types of waterproofing agents. Again, sodium silicate can be used, but maybe also bacterial suspensions. Now, these are some images from our lab, from Erik Slangen and Sanat Sangaji, PhD student in our lab who already graduated several years ago. They made bone-like concrete. So you see here a vertical section through a prism, where you see that the middle part is highly porous. And this is a longitudinal section where you actually see that this is a hollow part of the concrete through which healing agents can be delivered to the specific spots where a crack actually occurs. Now you can see it here. In this case, they used also fluorescent epoxies to press it through these hollow parts, and then you actually see that the epoxy indeed is nicely delivered in the zone where crack formation starts. Now Eric made a nice animation of this to show how it works. So here you see that you have an external reservoir where the healing agent is then pressed into the hollow parts of the concrete, so where the tube actually is. Now you see that the material is then nicely delivered to the parts where we see cracking, and this then results in healing. Beautiful animation, Eric. So this was an overview of what you can also find in literature. In the recent 2 years, a lot of review articles are being published on self-healing mechanisms. So I put them in the presentation. So find these review papers and go through them yourselves, and to see for what different types of concretes, which type of mechanisms would be most suitable. And now I would like to go over a couple of assessment methods. So how can we really assess the, let's say, the effectiveness of self-healing? Now for that, we first need to make some damage to our test specimen. Now, this is easier said than done, because if we damage concrete, we usually see that even if we consider prisms that are made in exactly the same way, that the type of damage that occurs is each time different. So cracks are of different width, maybe they are of different dimensions, so it's very difficult to make specific damage in such a controlled way that the damage is very much defined, well defined. So therefore, to do that, there are different options. So we can, for example, insert some damage in the concrete specimen by applying mechanical loading. So we can do this by 3 or 4 points bending. By 3-point bending, you typically get 1 crack. By 4-point loading, you usually see a sequential, a series of cracks that are being formed, and usually they're also smaller. And then you do bending under 3-point loading. Tensile splitting can be used under compression loading also. Now, sometimes you need a computer controlled system to really make sure that you control the damage formation in such a way that indeed you get very defined cracks. Now, we need these damaged specimens in order to study recovery of certain properties. Now, these properties can be very different. Can be mechanical properties, that can also be other properties, for example, those that are related to durability, like the ingress of aggressive chemicals, water tightness, permeability, maybe damage mechanisms related to frost damage. So then we would like to increase the resistance against frost damage, but could also be something that is related to aesthetics. Now, typically, we would like to see what is happening during the self-healing process. So for that, we can use visual or maybe also aided, so microscopic techniques. Now, they can be done in 2 ways, destructive or non-destructive. So if you do it in a non-destructive way, you just look with the microscope on the surface of your specimen to see what is happening. If there is any signs, visual signs of self-healing, like in the picture we see on the left side, you can also do destructive microscopic analysis. So then after some self-healing, you break your specimen and then you take some of the material that's being formed and you put it under the microscope. So the right image shows an electron microscopic image of limestone that's being formed in the crack. And in this, you can now clearly see imprints of bacteria. So this is some evidence that this self-healing was then actually due to microbes. So this is typically microscopy. We use that for visualization of the self-healing process. Now, you can also use another technique which is able to visualize self-healing process without the need to damage your specimen. So this can be done, for example, by X-ray CT scanning, computerized tomography. Sorry for that. We see here some images which I took from a nice paper, also from a collaboration of colleagues from Ghent University, and another paper from colleagues from Delft University, where they apply CT scanning to visualize, in this case, for example, how the distribution of the self-healing capsules in concrete is, but you can also use it to monitor over time how the self-healing process actually develops. Now, this can also be done at a very high resolution, depending on the quality of your CT scanner. So this is what our technician at Delft, Arjan Thijssen, has done. This is a living organism. It's a foraminifera. It is an organism which is only 1 millimeter big, and it is like corals. It has some algal symbionts, and it can make a very beautiful skeleton. So now imagine this is only 1 millimeter diameter, and you can see with CT scanning, you can look inside the skeleton and you can actually see how well it is, the architecture of this skeleton actually is. And the same you can do, of course, with concrete specimen. Then you can really see on a very high resolution where you have defects in your specimen, and if these defects are over time disappearing due to self-healing. So this is a very important non-destructive self-healing assessment technology. Another method, but is essentially doing the same, is by using acoustic techniques. So you use sound, ultrasonic sounds, so ultrasonic pulses, which can then also, using a computer, visualize let's say certain morphologies within the concrete matrix. So in this image you can see reinforcement bars, you can also see tubes, yellow tubes here which contain healing agents. You can see some capsules which are depicted here in green. So this is later on artificially is colored. So this also comes by from our colleagues from Ghent University. And this work is also reviewed by Liberato Ferrara from Italy, who also co-authored a very nice review paper. So this is another one published in Construction and Building Materials, which I advise you to study. Then we can look for methods that can help us to assess how we can recover certain specific performance properties. So the previous ones were just visualizing the healing process, but not so much related to a specific performance property. So now we would like to know, for example, if the self-healing occurs, to what extent does it indeed regain compressive strengths, or maybe flexural or tensile strengths? Now, for that you can do all kind of different loading tests. So here you see some examples of loading, where you first apply load on your specimen. So then you can follow the deformation, and then you can see that at a certain overloading event happens. Then you can, so this is the maximum load of your virgin specimen. Then you do a self-healing process, and then you can reload it, and then you can see to what extent the loading capacity was regained. Now you can do this under compressive loading, but you can also do this under tensile loading. Now another possibility is to look for water tightness. So there are different methods being developed over time to really quantify the water flow through a cracked specimen. And so when you have, for example, this graph shows when you have a non-healed specimen, you see that you have a lot of water flowing through your specimen in time. And when you have then a healing process going on, and after this self-healing process, you can again monitor for water permeability. And then if you see then a decrease in water permeability, you can actually quantify the difference between before and after self-healing, which gives you a quantitative result, self-healing process. Now, this specific method is using prisms, hollow prisms, which are then loaded in three-point bending so that you get a crack in the middle. So then you need a relatively complicated setup that can then measure the water that flows through the crack over time, and then you measure it by a weighing scale, and this allows you then to also follow over time how the let's say the healing process actually develops. Now, the previous one is a very labor-intensive method. One of our PhDs, Damien Palin, has developed a technique that allows you to handle a lot of different specimens at the same time. So what he did, he made relatively small cylinders and he split them, and then he glued the two halves together again using a specific spacer, width of a spacer, which determines then the actual crack width. Now then, before and after healing, he made this setup so that you can see here that at the same time you can measure 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 specimens for water permeability. So this allows you to do within one day to handle a lot of specimen. Another possibility is to look for capillary absorption. So then you make again a prism, which is using LVDTs. You can make a very defined crack width by 3-point loading, and then you don't look for water flow, but you actually look for how much water is taken up by your specimen. So this more or less depends on capillary force. So a certain crack width will result in capillary action. So that will result in uptake of water in your specimen. So there is a certain relation between crack width and the capillary action. So this can then also be followed over time. And if you have healing, then you see a change in capillary action, resulting also in different uptake of water by specimen. Now, we have also done this methodology. We used it in what we call a round robin test. So then we prepare specimen, send it around to different labs, and the different labs sometimes also can prepare their specimen according to a prescribed recipe. And then they do the whole testing procedure themselves. They make cracks, and then they also follow the healing of cracks. And then these results are then compared between the board trees to see if a healing process that is developed by one lab can also be reproduced by another lab. Now here we have another question, and that is, how can we now monitor and assess self-healing in outdoors structures? So this is the next step. First, we develop self-healing concepts in the laboratory. We do a lot of tests in the laboratory, but then if we are confident that it is a promising technique, we would like to go outdoors. Now, outdoors is not a lab, so that makes it usually much more difficult to really assess self-healing. So there is one study here published by colleagues from the UK, by Rob Davies. They did a relatively large experiment outdoors, where they made 6 different panels. And these panels, they checked for self-healing. So first they made by applying forces, they made by loading, they made cracks of specific crack width, 0.3 millimeter. And then they used different imaging techniques to follow the healing process. So they did it on the one hand by assessing the amount of load that can be applied on the structure before and after the self-healing process. But they also made photographs during the process of self-healing, and digital photographs, and they also did digital image analysis to follow the self-healing process. Now in Delft, we also have already started doing major outdoors applications, full-scale applications. And what we also typically do is we follow visually what happens to cracks. So do they indeed close? Can we quantify visually crack closure? But we also do functional performance tests. So typically we do water permeability tests to measure the water flow, but also the ingress of water to certain capillaries, like here, this is Karsten tube. So you apply a tube, you add some water to it, and then you can see how much time it takes before this water is absorbed in your, taken up by your concrete construction. And usually the more porous it is and the more cracked it is, the faster it will take up your water. So these are also possibilities to quantitatively determine the self-healing process. So my goodness, I did a lot of talking. It is already almost 10:15. I would like to stop here and take a short break. But first of all, I would like to know if there are some urgent questions. Does someone of our PhD students have an urgent question? So then unmute yourself and let me know.
Yes, I would like to know about more the capsules, because I'd like to know at which stage should I add these capsules to the paste, because I understand that the wall, the shawl.
Yes, you're saying your question is to when should you add the capsules to the concrete? Because
because I understand that the wall, the shell of the capsule must not be too hard, because I understand that in the moment at the damage it breaks. So I think when I should add these capsules, because in the moment that you are mixing, they can broke.
Mm-hmm. Now that is indeed a very important question. And a lot of research is done on that, and I cannot give you the answer, because it really depends on the type of capsule that you apply. Because what you say is completely correct. You would like to apply a capsule that contains healing agents. You want to add it to the concrete mix. So during the concrete mixing, the capsule should stay intact. So the capsule should be strong enough to contain the self-healing material inside. Then next step is that the concrete will set, it will harden, and during that process we must also have a certain connection with the cement stone, so the concrete matrix, with your capsule. Because if there is no bond, if you don't get a certain bond, then you run the risk that if a crack occurs, that it will go around. So it will not open your capsule. So there's a lot of chemistry involved here. So it depends on the one hand very much on the type of capsule wall that you apply, and whether this capsule wall will indeed form a bond with the concrete matrix. And then secondly, you have a certain strength of your capsule wall. And that strength should be relatively low, so lower than, let's say, the strength of the concrete matrix itself. Otherwise, the concrete will crack, but not the capsule. So I cannot really give you an answer, because it really depends on the type of capsule you apply and also the strength, mm-hmm. the type of concrete you apply. Mm-hmm. But you cannot do differently than apply all your capsules at the moment of concrete mixing.
Mm-hmm.
And so okay. If you have yes?
No, okay. Mm-hmm. And about the dispersion of these healing agents, there is some way to evaluate the dispersion when you adding to the paste?
Yes. So I would say I have shown you some different methodologies which you can use. And so typically you would need a non-destructive method, because you make your specimen and then you want to know your dispersion. So one possibility could then be CT scanning.
Mm-hmm.
Because your capsules are less dense than the concrete matrix. So with CT scanning, you should clearly see the distribution of your particles. And then you must make sure that the resolution of your CT scanning is high enough to allow you to recognize the individual particles. And this can, of course, be an issue. Depends on the capsule size. So if you really work with microcapsules, which are very, very small, then it might become more difficult to visualize them with CT scanning than when you use larger particles. So mm-hmm. With CT scanning, you can get to a very high resolution. Other option would be this acoustic technique. Now, I don't have experience with it myself, but what I learned from literature is that the resolution of acoustic techniques is usually much, much lower than with CT scanning. So with acoustic techniques, you can really see larger cracks. You can see tubes and the big capsules that you put in your concrete, but not the smaller ones.
Okay.
But those would be typically the non-destructive techniques that you can use to visualize how well the dispersion of your capsules in the concrete actually is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you for your question. So let's have a short break. How much? Let's say 5 minutes, so we can go to toilets or get a coffee. And then we will start. I have on my clock now, it's 17 past 10, so let's start at 10:25. So that would be in 7 minutes again. In the meantime, I will put up the second presentation, and then I can also have a look at the chat, whether there are maybe more questions that came in. Okay, let's start again in 7 minutes' time. So Erik, shall we continue again?
Yeah, I think it's 24. Yeah,
it's about time, so, because yeah. I have a couple of more slides to go, actually 50. But I will go relatively quick, because in this second part, I would like to go more into practice. And I would like you to show some work that we have done in Delft on self-healing concrete, also about valorization. So so going towards, let's say, also practice, and also going towards commercial applications, and see if there's any feasibility in that. So let me start again. There was one question in the chat, ladies and gentlemen, about bacteria in concrete, so how they must be encapsulated and whether the bacteria should be protected and how long they would last in the concrete. And I will come to that in my second part of the presentation, so I hope to be able to answer that question. So this second part will be about projects and valorization. So in Delft, we have in the past worked on different mechanisms of self-healing concrete. And one of them is using bacteria. And with that one, we are now advanced in the sense that we also started a startup company, which is now officially called Scale-Up Company, because it's already marketing self-healing concrete for more than 5 years. And this technology is based on bacteria that form limestone. Now, in this first picture, we see how it actually works. It is relatively simple. We have bacteria, live bacteria, and when they are live and active, they start to eat and convert a nutrient, a food source, and that's in our case calcium lactate, and they convert it to limestone. So this is a process that in a kind of analogous way also happens in nature. There we see the formation of sandstones and limestones, but that's a process that takes thousands and even millions of years to make very large constructions, and this is what we try to speed up in the laboratory. So what we do, first of all, is very important that we make use of spores of bacteria. Now, we have in nature different types of bacteria, and one specific group has the ability to make spores. Now, these spores are like seeds of plants. They are dormant cells. They have a very, very thick cell wall, and that allows them to survive very harsh conditions. Now, these conditions can be pH values up to 12. It can be anoxic conditions, it can be very dry conditions, and in science it is shown, already proven, that these spores can remain dormant for more than 200 years. So even after 200 years, if you supply them with enough moisture and nutrients, then like the seeds of plants, they will start to germinate and then they will convert from a spore into an active cell. Now, one part of the question I can therefore already answer. If you add spores to the concrete mix, you can be sure that they will survive. However, if you add active cells to bacteria to a concrete mix, they will instantly die within a few seconds. Because the concrete mix is too harsh for active cells, pH goes up to 12, sometimes even 13, high mixing conditions, so that this will not work. So therefore, it is that we always encapsulate the bacteria. So even the bacterial spores, we do encapsulate them, because if during the mixing stage pH goes up to 13, we would like to have the bacteria being protected from these harsh mixing conditions. So at the moment concrete cracks, so when it has set and cracks, then usually the pH is much lower. And if we then have ingress water, so water ingressing the crack, we usually see a lowering of the internal pH of concrete to values below 11, so around 11, 11.5. And this is suitable for the bacterial spores to germinate. Now again, it depends very much on which bacterium you work, because some of these spore-forming bacteria are what we call alkaliphilic, so they love alkaline conditions. So they will become typically already active at a pH value of 11.5. But other species, which are not alkaliphilic, they will only start to become active at pH values of around 9. So that means that you already have, you need very aged concrete, maybe carbonated concrete, which does not feature a very high pH value. Now, what we do is we take the bacterial spores and we take the nutrients, so the food. In our case, it is calcium lactate or polymer of lactic acid. So that is then PLA, polylactic acid. And together with the bacterial spores, we encapsulate them, and we do it by a melting process and extrusion to an extruder. And then this extruded material we crush and grind until we get a particle size that is required. And in our case, we typically use healing agent particles of a size between 0.5 and 2 millimeter. Now, what happens is, if this comes into contact with water, we see that the spores become active, they germinate, and the active cells then start to convert the lactate, the calcium lactate, to calcium carbonate and CO2. Now, what I meant in my, what I already mentioned in my previous presentation, if you have sufficient portlandite minerals, calcium hydroxide, in your concrete matrix, we see additional formation of calcium carbonate because of the reaction of CO2 produced by the bacteria and the portlandite minerals. So this will, in addition, for more calcium carbonate. So stoichiometrically speaking, if we have one molecule of calcium lactate, it can be converted in total to 6 molecules of calcium carbonate. And so we need for the healing agent 2 components, the bacterial spores, and we need the nutrients. Now, we have at the moment one very active PhD in our group, Emmanuel Rossi. And he is also looking in other types of nutrients that can be used for the self-healing process. And these nutrients we derive from wastewater, because we want to be sustainable. We want to work with materials that result in a very low environmental footprint and are renewable. So there's a possibility to get from wastewater very specific fatty acids, and we call them alkanoates. And these alkanoates can also act as a food source, so very much similar to lactates. They can be acted as a food source, nutrient source for the bacteria, which they can then also, in the concrete matrix, convert to limestone, calcium carbonate. Now, in literature, you will find a lot of publications on a different way of bacterial metabolism. So that is not what we use in Delft, conversion of calcium lactate or alkanoates, but that is due to the conversion of urea. Now, urea is something that humans produce. You can find it in your pee. And urea is the chemical formula is a carbon oxide which has two ammonia groups attached to it. Now, this is urea, and we have specific bacteria again, and some of them are spore forming, like Sporosarcina pasteuri, and they produce a specific enzyme which is called urease, and this urease is able to hydrolyze, to split urea into ammonia and carbonate ions. Now, in the presence of sufficient calcium ions, so which is then provided in form of calcium chloride, you get then afterwards a chemical reaction that also results in the formation of calcium carbonate. Now, you see here the stoichiometry of this formula, which shows that for the conversion of one molecule of urea, you have the production of one molecule of calcium carbonate, so limestone. However, you also have the production of two molecules of ammonium chloride. Now, in literature, most of the time you read that this is a bio-based process and sustainable, but in sustainability there is more than bio-based, because ammonium chloride is not a very nice component to throw in the environment. Because too much ammonia results in a process what we call eutrophication. So that is overloading of the environment with nutrients. So that usually then results in unwanted growth of specific organisms that are not wanted. And sometimes you can also get toxic levels of ammonia. So if you use this process in practice, it means that you have to take actions to make sure that you lower or that you wash out this ammonium chloride from the environment. So this is something that you really have to consider if you use this process, because otherwise it would not be very environmental friendly. So although it is bio-based, be careful with the environmental friendliness of this method. Now, this last metabolism of urea hydrolysis has been used in literature, a lot of literature studies in the laboratory, but also outdoors, and specifically, actually, to stabilize soils. So one advantage of the method is that it also increases the pH value of the environment. So in cases when you work in a very low pH environment, like in specific soils, then this reaction increases the pH, but also helps to precipitate calcium carbonate. So the higher the pH, the better, the faster calcium carbonate will precipitate. Now, in the concrete matrix, this is usually not required because there's already sufficient alkalinity in the concrete. However, if you go outdoors to sediments, for example, then this would be very beneficial. So there has been done a lot of scientific work on this to see how this process of urea hydrolysis can also help to stabilize soils via the formation, due to the formation of calcium carbonate, so limestone, that can then glue the sand particles together and result in more stable soils. So in back to Delft, so where we use the bacteria, the bacterial spores, so they're actually a catalyst of the chemical reaction, and we use the nutrients, the food components, and we pack them together in particles. So then you can use a reservoir like expanded clay particles, but you can also do powder compression techniques or melting and extrusion techniques, where you can then form these particles and add them to the concrete mix. Now, we usually get the question, is it not bad to add bacteria to the concrete mix? Is it not dangerous for our health? And then I always say, well, you have to realize that what we normally, in normal standard concrete, we really already apply a lot of bacteria. Because in typical drinking water, tap water, drinking water, you have more than 50,000 living bacteria per milliliter. So that means in a typical concrete mix, if we add 175 liters of water, you already apply more than 8 × 10⁹, so this is billion bacteria to the concrete mix. Now, these are living bacteria, not dangerous for our health, but they will instantly die because they are not compatible with the concrete mix, because these are active bacteria which cannot resist the very high pH values that we find in concrete. So the only thing that we do is that we replace these tap water bacteria for the specific bacteria that are able to form spores. And of course, we also make sure that the bacteria that we use are not pathogenic. So they are not dangerous for humans, not dangerous for the environment. In principle, we have in biology and microbiology, we make a distinction in 4 categories of bacteria. Category group 1 are very harmless bacteria to which we are already exposed on a daily basis. So we are resistant against those bacteria. They do not make us ill. So those are the bacteria that we use in self-healing concrete. And we use them in the same amounts, same numbers as the bacteria that occur in tap water. So we are essentially not really modifying or changing the concrete mix in terms of numbers of bacteria. Now, what is beneficial for these bacteria? I have to look at the time to make sure that I finish in time. They consume oxygen, which can help to protect the steel against corrosion. But they also produce limestone, which can improve water tightness of the concrete because they heal cracks and also reduces porosity. What can, for example, also help to increase the resistance against frost damage in concrete. So we, what we do over the years, we have developed different, let's say, generations of healing agents. So the first ones was where we used expansive clay particles as a carrier material for the bacteria and the nutrients. Then we used powder compression in the second generation, so we made tablets, but they were relatively big and large, so too large for our purposes. So then we changed to melting and extrusion process and also granulation to make particles size particles in the size that we wish to have. So this is an animation which in a view of time I will not show in this animation, which was made by a UK television channel. It shows how in Delft we have developed the self-healing concrete and how it should be added to the concrete mix and how it essentially works, but that I will now explain. So the methods that we typically use is 1, microscopy to follow the process of self-healing. So you see that in this image on the left side, you see a cracked specimen and you see some defect in the specimen. So the exact specimen you see on the other picture on the right hand side, this is after, I think it was 4 weeks underwater, where you see then activation of the bacteria and formation of limestone that at least visually shows that we have healing of cracks and the defects. Then we have also done work with the second generation of healing agent in Delft, where we use these tablets. And with that, we could actually show that we have the capacity to heal cracks up to 1 millimeter. But that depends really on the dosage of the, so let's say, the amount of healing agent that you add to a cubic meter of mix. Now, what we also do in Delft, we like to use an approach by showing at least 3 different properties. So we would like to show functional properties like improvement of water tightness. So what is the functional performance that we regain? We would like also to see evidence, so like mineral formation. So what is the actual mechanism? Does it indeed result in what type of healing? So in our case, mineral formation. But we also want to make sure that it is the bacteria that we add to the concrete mix that actually do the process. So we want to follow the activity of the bacteria. We want to see some evidence that actually the bacteria that are doing the self-healing process. So for that, we then developed over the last years what we call the third generation of healing agent. So this is based on these lactic acid polymers, which can be melted and extruded and then mixed with other nutrients and bacterial spores, can then be grinded to obtain a granule size that is required. So as I mentioned, between 0.5 and 2 millimeter. Now, then we did a lot of tests in our laboratory first to see how compatible this healing agent is with the concrete mix, because what you do not want is to negatively affect other properties of your concrete. Now, in this graph, I will not go in all the details, but here you see that we applied a dosage of 15 kilogram of this healing agent per cubic meter of concrete in a concrete mix that was based on ordinary Portland cement, SEM 1. Now you see in the different mixes, you see different effects, because here it shows strength development over in time. So 3 days is blue, 7 days is reddish brown, and 28 days is green. Now you see here this with the different versions of the healing agent, we obtain different results. Now, and typically, let me see if going to the next picture. So typically, if we compare to the reference, so the very last set of bars is the reference specimen. So there we did not add any healing agent. We see that some of the mixes actually start to perform better in terms of strength development. But what we see here is some effects that we see, for example, that at this very high dosage of 15 kilogram, we see that we have lower strengths at 3 days, but higher strengths in some cases at 28 days. So this is something very important to realize in practice. If you're going to use this very high dosage, then you should be careful by taking away the formwork, because in the early days, you may still have a low strength that will be caught up after 7 days, and after 28 days, it's even higher. This is just an example of a very high dosage. And we did more experiments also with other dosages. So here you see experiments with 5, 10 or 15 kilogram. And now we can actually see here that we have, depending on the dosage, so here again is the reference, that we also find, let's say, an optimal dosage of 5 kilograms of healing agents per cubic meter, because there you see that you do not have a decreased strength at 3 days and not at 7, and even higher strengths at 28 days. So I just want to show you this, because there is always a relationship between the dosage of the healing agent and the effects, other effects you see on concrete properties. So this is for, and this is determined for Portland-based cements, and it's also we also have determined it for other types of cementitious binder systems in concrete. And this is something that you really have to figure out first before you start applying your healing agent in practice. Otherwise, you might get some unwanted effects. Now, so now we use this also in commercial applications, and the typical dosage with use is 5 to 10 kilograms, so that's optimal. And the cost of this healing agent is about €8 per kilogram. Now, this is still substantial, because in one of the very first images in the first presentation, I showed you that the cost of a cubic meter of concrete is roughly in the region of €80 per cubic meter. And if you apply now 5 kilograms of healing agents, then you would add €40 to the costs. And if you want to have higher self-healing capacity, then you add 10 kilograms, so then you double the price of the concrete. So this is now the cost level of the healing agent that we developed in Delft. So it is significant, but depending on your application, you can make cost-benefit assessment to see if it is worthwhile to add this healing agent. I have to speed up a little bit. So what we also do is we measure the metabolic performance of the bacteria. so that we can do using oxygen sensors. So when we have a concrete specimen and we submerge it in the water, we can follow with an oxygen sensor whether the bacteria are active. And if they are active, they start to consume oxygen, and we can see that this in an oxygen profile. If you make a profile of oxygen concentration through the water column going towards the surface of your specimen, then in case of active bacteria, you see a sudden decrease in oxygen concentration very close to your specimen surface, what shows you that bacteria are actually active. And from this decrease in oxygen concentration, you can calculate the rate of oxygen consumption. So how fast in time do they consume oxygen? And from that rate, you can then also calculate stoichiometrically how much calcium carbonate is being formed. Now, if you monitor this over time, you can see this in this graph on the right hand side, then you can see that it typically takes about 2 days before the bacteria become active. So you have a specimen with bacteria, self-healing concrete specimen, you put it under water, then it takes 2 days for the spores to germinate and start to grow and make a relatively high biomass of active bacteria. And then after 2 days, you see that the oxygen concentration rate starts to increase, and then over time it increases, and then it peaks at around 7 to 8 days, and this is because you have exponential formation of biomass, and then at a certain moment you see a decrease in oxygen consumption rate, and this is because nutrients start to become depleted. So this is the relationship between the dosage, so the amount of healing agent that you add, and the self-healing capacity you get. And then also under the microscope, we follow, so do we see indeed crack healing? So these are some examples. On the top side, we see autogenous healing. So this is in concrete without healing agent. And in the bottom part, we see two examples of before and after healing with bacterial concrete, where we see very nice healing, what takes about 2 months time. We also make thin sections. So then we look in depth. So where do we have self-healing? So this is work of Emmanuel Rossi, our PhD candidate. And there we can clearly see that most of the limestone is actually formed on the surface part of the crack. So where it is exposed to a lot of oxygen that is coming from the water. So in deeper parts of the crack, we hardly see any limestone formation. And the reason for this is that oxygen becomes very limited inside the crack. So our technology is very much based on oxygen consuming bacteria. So it means that deeper inside the crack, there's no oxygen, so that the steel is at this moment very well protected against corrosion. But there you don't see any limestone precipitation, but you do see it at the surface, at, let's say, the mouth of the crack, where you see a lot of limestone formation, what results in water tightness. So if we take some samples of this limestone that's being formed and we put it under the ESEM microscope, we can clearly see the imprints of the bacteria. So these on the right hand side, you see a light microscope. Oh no, this is also an environmental scanning electro microscopic image of actual living bacteria. So you see that they are rod shaped, about 2 micrometers in length. And you can actually very nicely see the imprints in this limestone. Now, these are some images of permeability tests that we then also do to relate to functional performance. So how well does our healing agent actually work to make concrete waterproof? And here you see some results again of Emmanuel, which shows that you have also the reference specimens without healing agents. They result in autogenous healing, resulting in about 50% reduction of water tightness or leakage. And we see that with the lactate-based healing agents, we have some variation in the results, but on average, it's about 80 to 90% healing improvement of water tightness of the specimen. And with the alkanoates, which were extracted from wastewater, we also see a very high closure of cracks, resulting in very high water tightness improvement. And also here you see that the variation is very small. So that means that the concept that Emmanuel is working on seems to work very well. Also here we see a lot of imprints of bacteria. Now, just to show you a few images, I will not show everything in view of time, because maybe we have a few questions. I will just go through these slides very shortly to show you some practical examples, what we have done, full-scale applications, healing agents. We went to the concrete batching plant, and here you see 4 cubic meters of concrete that is being mixed before it goes into the concrete truck mixer. With this concrete, we can make prefab a concrete. So it's shown here in this application. This is a wastewater treatment tank made of prefabricated elements of self-healing concrete. Here you see the tank is now already more than 2 years in full use. But we have also done a larger project on in situ cast concrete. So here you see the truck mixers driving to the site. Here you see all the formwork, where the concrete is then being cast, and this is a nice project. This is a water reservoir of dimensions of 50 meter by 5 meter by 5 meter containing water. Here we see another project where we have done casting of water retaining basement walls, also large scale. This is a former Royal Palace of the Netherlands, where we have applied self-healing concrete in the basement walls. And actually a project what we are now going to do, I will stop here, is a demonstrator where we would like to show that we can actually reduce part of the reinforcements, part of the reinforcement that actually controls the crack width of concrete. And if we can save 20 to 30 kilograms of steel per cubic meter of concrete, we can actually use that money to spend on self-healing. So then we would get cracks of, in case of a watertight, waterproof container, water container reservoir, we should have no cracks, but we will in this case allow cracks to occur up to 0.4 millimeter, because now we count on self-healing. And self-healing can then make sure that these 0.4 millimeter cracks disappear completely, resulting in waterproof constructions. So in this case, we can then save more money with reducing the reinforcement steel and compensate that with the cost of healing agent. So in this demonstrator, we want to show that it is also cost benefit positive balance if we apply self-healing concrete for these type of structures. Erik, I think I should stop here. I have a number of more slides, but it's almost 11 o'clock, and I just want to know from the PhD students if there may be some questions before we stop at 11. Is there a question? One of the PhDs, just unmute yourself, yes.
Can you hear me? I'm Davide.
Yes.
I have two questions, actually. The first one is on about your last slide. You mentioned that there are a lot of environmental benefits, but my question is, did you develop an LCA analysis? And if yes, which system boundary did you use? Was it a cradle to gate, or just a cradle to gate that took into account the extended durability, so the extended service life?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. We have indeed done LCA assessments. So first of all, on the healing agent itself. So that would be cradle to gate. So how much energy, how much raw materials do we need to make the healing agent? So per kilogram of healing agent. Now this LCA turns out to be very positive because we only use bio-based materials. So we use bacteria, and also the nutrients are actually bio-based. And actually the LCA is better for the alkanoates, which we retrieve from wastewater, because there we work with natural wastes instead of using the lactates, because the lactates are produced from corn, and corn is a food product. So there you have some competition with food, so which is not so good. So therefore we go for the, in the future, we like to go for the alkanoates. But more importantly, in an LCA study, you should indeed consider the full service life of a construction. Now, so this means in this LCA, we can now show that we can reduce the amount of steel per cubic meter of concrete by almost 30 kilograms. And if we replace this 30 kilograms of steel with 5 kilograms of healing agents, then the LCA turns out to be very positive, at least on this aspect. Now, concerning the service life, this is something that we cannot be sure of, because we do not know at the moment how long actually our concrete should last. So we are doing durability tests to also to accelerated laboratory tests to prove that the concrete is at least of the same quality as the traditional concrete. But of course, what we aim for with self-healing concrete, that we can do less maintenance and repair. So this would be very beneficial in, let's say, category B of your LCA assessment, where you consider the use phase of your concrete. And also that we will actually be able to extend the service life of the concrete. So that will also then reduce the environmental impact performance. But it is very nice what you say. You really have to consider in an LCA study, not only cradle to gate, but you have to consider cradle to cradle over the whole service life of your construction. And this is something we are working on. And it is, at least for now, it shows that we have a lot of benefits by applying self-healing agents.
Do you remember the reduction of environmental impacts more or less in comparison to the references or not?
Yes. So the let's say if we only consider the impact category of global warming potential, let's say CO2 and energy, then we have per kilogram of healing agents, we have roughly 1 kilogram of CO2 production. In case we reduce the amount of steel, 30 kilograms per cubic meter of concrete, the steel has about 2 kilograms of CO2 per kilogram of steel. So we can reduce, let's say, 60 kilograms of CO2, and we add 5 in form of healing agents. So that would already result in a reduction of more than 55 kilograms of CO2 per cubic meter of concrete. So this only relates now to the global warming potential, but it also more or less is works to the same extent for other impact categories.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you for your question. Do you have any suggestions on how to measure the toxic side effects of urea hydrolysis, leaching test of resulting mortar concrete? Yes, indeed. So you can stoichiometrically, you can already calculate how much urea will be formed. So as I mentioned in the formula for the conversion to one molecule of urea, you produce 2 molecules of ammonia. Now, this is at the moment we have in Europe, we have a lot of problems with nitrogen loading, ammonia loading in environments. So this shows that you have to make sure that you wash and clean your concrete so that you find ways to reduce, get rid of your ammonia loading. So, are there more questions? I see that our colleague from Ghent, Willy, also entered. Hello, Willy. Nice to see you. It is already 11, so you should take over.